All right, hi everybody, I'm Anthony Walt. You've chosen to stay here long enough for my part, so you can call me Tony. I'm the director of 3D Motion at Effect UI. My team is responsible for the planning, creation, and implementation of rich media across Effect UI's projects. Since we've got the dev hats on right now, I'm going to start with the third one. I'll circle back around to the other two. So just a quick show of hands, who out here is working in HTML5 and CSS3 right now? Is there anyone who's not working with it right now? Okay, I think it's pretty understandable. This was one of the things we had to deal with the Blue Angel site. This is a snapshot as of April 1st of the current browsers and their current support for HTML5 and CSS3. So you can see there's still quite a big gap there in the blue. At Effected UI, we believe it's okay to go on and use HTML5 and CSS3 provided one of two conditions exists. The first one is that you're using a locked-down browser and device that you're supporting, so you know how it's going to behave. And the second one is that you use some form of progressive enhancement or graceful degradation. For the Blue Angel site, that's the route we had to take. We also, just to further our cause, chose to use elements that were supported across all of our target browsers. So the audio tag, the video tag, the canvas, CSS3 transforms, and semantic elements. So once you've decided to use HTML5, the question is, where are you going to use it? What are you going to use it for? This is just a quick snippet of the homepage of the Blue site to show you what we did.
Solos, we're clear for takeoff. Solos, ready to rock Seattle, boss.
Okay, the audio was actually supposed to be playing the whole time there. You'll see that again later. So what you saw there, though, is you saw that transition of all the elements animating in. You should have heard audio. The audio track separate from the video track, so there's also the video. The audio is separate because it plays in a different duration. Things you didn't see, the semantic elements. So why did we do this? Why did we use the elements that way on the homepage? Mainly, it's just to create a really good, strong first impression. You want to set the tone and mood for your users. That visceral experience is going to impact the way they see the rest of the site. It also helps tie the homepage to the feature-rich Silverlight pages. Gives it a little more action. And as Chad mentioned earlier, we chose not to do Silverlight on the homepage because we didn't want people getting prompted to download a plugin for something that is essentially extra. It's a background element. It's not a feature that they necessarily came to see. So that was our choice for doing that in HTML. So what did we learn? Number one thing we learned, supported does not mean standard. So you can see elements that are supported across all the browsers. Doesn't mean they're going to behave the same way across all those browsers. This is an example here. So for the to animate the elements in, we used CSS3 transforms and some JavaScript timers. You can see the item on the left, the navigation rotates and slides back more in line with the vision demo. The element on the right does not rotate at all, and it zooms up towards the camera. So what we learned from this is you need to prototype your code, build that thing out, and test it across all the different browsers. It's okay if it's not exactly the same across them, but just make sure it's looking good. And also, build it on its own. Make sure it's going to work, make sure it's looking nice before you plug it all in together, and then it starts breaking. We found the animations are working great, the video's working great, put them together, falls apart. So just make sure that you're building things on their own before you plug them all together. The other thing about that is, beware the beta. So all this development was taking place while Firefox was in 3.6, IE was still in version 8. We're working away, things are looking good. We've got everything up for about a month, and then suddenly you get the phone call. Hey, the video on the site's not working. What'd you do? Oh, I didn't do anything. There was a release last night of the new platform preview. Why don't we check that out? Turns out something in the code changed. Site stopped working, we had to go fix it again. So just kind of pay attention to that. Another thing we learned, supported does not equal standard, especially in video. Video is horrible for us when it came to being consistent. First thing is, when you're working with video, you're gonna need to output to three different codecs, the MP4, or three different formats. The MP4, which has the codecs H.264 and AAC. Overall, it does deliver the best quality for the file size. However, it is license encumbered, which means if you're gonna charge people to see video content on your website and it's encoded with the MP4 codec, that means you need to get a license from the MPEG-LA. They have relaxed their rules a little bit since the whole WebM thing came about, which is the next format, WebM. It uses the VP8 and Vorbis codecs. It does do pretty well in terms of matching the MP4. It does struggle a little bit when you get down to smaller resolutions like 320 by 240. It is supposed to be an open codec. I know there's some litigation going on around this, so just kind of FYI. The third is OGG, O-G-G, and that's generally for older versions of Firefox 3.5, I think 3.0. Theora and Vorbis are the two codecs in that one. So what I'm going to show you here is just a quick experience we had with playing the video. This is playing on a dual port with the exact same file being served, and it's just in two different browsers. So you can see the one on the left rips. It's just got that little snag in there. This exact same setup playing on a single port machine didn't have a problem. On another dual port machine didn't have a problem. So same browser, same format, same exact specs, two different machines, maybe one's got a different graphics card in it. That's what you get. The event models were not consistent. So working with media elements, like the audio element at the beginning, we, in order to get the ended event to fire, we had to loop it. So that made a lot of sense. Thank you for that one. That took a while. Progress events. Again, they weren't firing consistently. There's the idea that they're keeping the amount of data loaded in the event, and now I think they're pushing it over to the actual video itself. So to get all this figured out and to unify it all, we used a nice little library called VideoJS. It'll be in my resources. That's a good thing to use to kind of unify that. Poster frames. So earlier versions of iOS don't support poster frames, the poster frame attribute, so it's a good idea to just take that poster frame image and then code it into the first, say, 5 frames or so of your video itself, just to ensure that you do get that poster frame experience. Profiles and resolution restrictions. Mobile devices. When you're serving video up to mobile, you have to use a lower profile, like baseline, because it's a lot harder for mobile devices to decode something with a high profile. High profile is nice, you can use it because it's generally for the same amount of quality, you get a much smaller file. The resolution restrictions, again, a mobile device will think, oh, it's MP4, I can play that. Goes to play it, realizes the resolution's too big, and it fails. Another thing of note is those ticks on the nav across the top and bottom, those slide when you roll over. We had to disable those because it was too much JavaScript running. And to support all the transparency between each of those ticks, because they've got some drop shadow behind them, and so it was ripping our video pretty badly. So just when you're working with video, watch the amount of JavaScript you're doing and watch how much you're asking the computer to do, because you can max out that processor pretty quick, and it just destroys the video quality. So this is the setup we used for our video tag. The video OGG at the top there, that's sometimes also seen as OG.OGV. We were having troubles with that, so we went ahead and stuck with OGG itself. If your MIME types are not right, that's going to cause a lot of headache. All of your code's set up, but the MIME types aren't set up appropriately, and your site doesn't work. Easiest way to test that is take that href that's in your source tag and just plug that into your browser and see if it serves up a video or if it asks you to download the file. The other thing to this is just beware of the gzip or any sort of compression on the server side. A lot of our videos, we're having trouble getting the events to come across appropriately or the videos to play appropriately, and it's because they're getting gzipped on the server. So just make sure that that's not occurring when you're working with the video. In the video tag itself, some of the things of note, MP4 comes first in the list of sources. That's because some of the iOS devices, the MP, it only looks at the first source of all of your source options. And so if it doesn't see MP4 there, it's just not going to be able to play it. Codecs, you can see that in the type attribute, we've put the codecs in. It's going to help the browser client determine whether or not it can play the video before having to download a little and say, oh, this is MP4 or something, I can't play it. And then one thing you'll note is that there is only three sources in there. There is no fallback contained inside the video tag. We handle that a different way, but if you are doing it, it's a good idea to have that in there. So with HTML5 comes media, lots and lots of media, hopefully. One of the things we learned is just be kind to your users, okay? It's going to save you money, and it's going to save your users time and money. So bandwidth on your side, storage on your side, and on their side, these guys, they've got data plans, right? So you don't want them to be downloading, you know, something that's 6 megabytes when you can send over the exact same thing in half a meg, because they got to pay for that. So the audio section, the uncompressed wave, that's what it was, about 6 megabytes. We used MP3 and AUG to serve, and those two are really all we needed to serve for everybody. Fraction of the size. The video. So this is, again, the whole mobile versus desktop. With the video, we weren't going to be serving it to data to people on mobile because it is a background element, and we're not going to force them to download a video as a background element on their phone. So most of the time, these mobile devices, you have to opt in for video anyway. So instead, we first did MP4 with a baseline profile, came out at about 12.7 megabytes. By kicking it up to a high profile, we're able to get it down to 6.38 megabytes. So on the home page alone, between the audio and the video, we're saving you about 12 megs. So that's definitely not small potatoes. The images, so in the aircraft section, there's about 850 images in there. Pretty typical that people just go in, save out Photoshop, 60% quality, get a reasonably good JPEG, that's what we did. 97.3 megabytes for all of the images together in the entire aircraft section. Decent, but not good enough. So we went back and looked into fireworks. Again, about the same exact amount of quality as the Photoshop 60%, saving out fireworks 80%. And we were able to get that down to about 78.7 megabytes. Decent. Can we go further? We used a little program called Advanced JPEG Compressor. Got the same image group down to 53.7 megabytes. So this was done because Advanced JPEG Compressor allows us to separate the chroma and luminance channels when it comes to compression.
Is that all the sprites?
These are just all the single images.
Single.
It also allows us to compress our images at different detail levels. So areas of finer detail may get less compression or more compression. And then we also use Smush It on all the images to strip the metadata, make sure that the image was as small as humanly possible. So just a comparison, the image on the left is 310 kilobytes, it's the raw image. The image on the right, 65. I don't know about you, but it looks pretty comparable to me. So that's the HTML5 section. I'm going to slide over to the rich media. So on the site, that's the audio, the homepage score, video, various featurettes, interviews, and the inside the demo section, and then the 3D, which is the aircraft section, and the inside the demo. So as we move into this, just want to do a quick little thing here. This is the F-18 Hornet. I'm sure you guys are familiar with it. You've probably seen it a couple times in our presentation. Take a look at that and get that in your head. I'm going to read one of the maneuvers, and I just want you to visualize this. This is the sort of thing we had to work with when we had to figure out how to animate the maneuvers. It's one of the descriptions. So thinking of that plane, the Delta formation, by the way, is the six planes in a kind of triangular formation. So thinking of that plane, I just want you to imagine this. In Delta formation from crowd right on the show line, all six aircraft will commence a loop in formation approaching center point. At the vertical down above center point, the six aircraft will slowly separate and exit in six different directions, leveling out. Heading outbound on ingress-egress lines, a couple of nautical miles out, each pilot will perform a half-cubinate reversal turn towards center point, descend to its respective altitude, and cross at center point. And then just to note, all outbound aircraft are, I can't show you the numbers, but a certain foot above ground level to a certain amount of nautical miles. Inbound and outbound altitudes are routinely flown higher during the first half of the season. So my question is, how many of you actually visualized all of that? And how many of you were sitting there halfway through, quit listening to me, and were like, the media guy is boring the heck out of me. What the heck? I'm going to show you that same exact thing now. And it's been sped up, but this is the video, and this is 45 seconds of the same maneuver. And so what I'm trying to show you here is, okay, so on the bottom, the 3D, it shows the entire maneuver. You can see everything. If you're at the show, you can only see what's in the top right. So when the jets split off, you can only see one. In the 3D at the bottom, you can see them all. Top left, top middle, you can see what's going on with the pilots. What are they seeing? What does their faces look like? You can't hear it right now because it's sped up and it sounds like Mickey Mouse, but there are audio comms coming from the pilots, as well as the spectator audio that you can toggle between. So what I'm trying to get across here is, in 45 seconds, less time than it took me to read that last description, I'm showing all of you exactly what's going on, what the maneuver is. And so to me, that's the power of media. That's a lot of data I'm giving you in 45 seconds, and everyone in the room is now thinking the same thing when I mention that maneuver. And you may say to yourself, well, you know, I work in banking or finance. Like, that's the type of development I do. How does this apply to me? And what I would say to you is, just imagine being able to transmit that amount of data to somebody when it comes to, like, a mortgage application. So when it comes to dealing with the media, the first thing we have to do is gather some requirements. What's the purpose of the media? That's going to inform things like our pacing, our transitions, edits, the audio, if there is audio, what kind of audio is it going to be, the size, and then the fidelity of the models if we're working with 3D. Updates. Are we going to be updating this thing? Is the client going to be updating it? That's going to affect things like our file structure and how we hand things off. Playback context. So when it comes to working with video, you generally want to work in multiples of 16. If you can't get that, multiples of 8. If you can't get that, multiples of 4. Why? Encoders and decoders generally work in image blocks of 16. So just try and get your resolutions divisible by 16, and in general, same amount of quality, better quality, smaller file size for your videos. Some codecs will go down to blocks of 8 and 4, so that's why those are also good options. What's the player going to be? That's going to inform things like our format, our container, and our codecs. So that's going to tell us whether or not we can have transparency or an alpha channel. Or we have to consider something like chroma key. As Chad mentioned earlier, we didn't go with chroma key. The jets have that little smoke tail behind them. Doesn't play well when you try to do something like chroma key. You'd have lots of blockiness in there. So that's one of the reasons why we stepped away from that. The format's going to determine whether or not we can embed cue points to trigger events during the video. So things like telemetry. Can we have the video fire an event that triggers the update of the telemetry? File size, what are the implications of file size? Certain formats are definitely bigger than others, and certain ones compress better than others. And then how is the client going to review it? If we're working in some format like, say, DivX, you know, is that easy for the client to consume and review? And then are there going to be alternate uses of the media that we produce? So as you can see here, the video, the big video is what we do as a player on the site. May not always exist that way. It may be kicked out to Vimeo, YouTube, or some other media player. And as you can see, the players on the bottom, some of them, the player controls are getting up over the bottom of the video. Well, a lot of times when you're doing interviews and stuff, you may have somebody's name strapped down there. Well, that, you know, it's pretty bad if the player controls are obscuring that. So it's just something to think about. As well as, I mean, the media people here did a really good job. Unfortunately, when I was testing this, I was getting a lot worse in terms of safe rating and title saving. But you never know what device you may end up on. Developers, you may hate me for this, designers, you may sympathize, but do you notice how on the slides here, on the left corner, the mix is a lot closer to the edge of the screen than the effective UI is on the right side? So it's just the amount of space there. It's because a little bit of our slide is getting cut off. So a lot of people think all this fancy equipment and stuff, you know, you don't have to worry about title saving and action saving anymore. Yeah, it's less of a concern, but it does happen. So just pay attention to that. Okay, so the one thing you got to get across to your shareholders as quickly as possible is that quality media does take time to produce. So if you're going to make changes, get approvals and such, get that all done with storyboards, animatics, previews, prototypes. Kick out your previews and prototypes to dev so they can start working with those at the beginning to ensure they're going to work. Because any changes that occur after production has begun may or may not, but in general they can, have huge cost implications and time implications. So just an example of that, this render right here, that's an hour to render that off. And that's not a small machine, that's a quad core with 8 gigs of RAM. So if you need, you have 850 of these in the aircraft section, if you need to change the name of the pilot on that jet, it's gonna take a long time to re-render. So the video sections on the site, the interviews, the featurettes, and inside the demo, that's what I'll address now. Cindy mentioned having too much water and not a drop to drink. That's the media that we received. That's about, it's an FTP site, 2 hard drives, I think they're about a terabyte each, or no, not 100 gigs maybe. We had 55 DVDs to peruse through. So it's important to catalog your media. That's the first one. We use Google Docs to just review all the media. What's on every disk? Is it quality? Is the quality good enough that we can use it? Is this something the Blue Angels have approved to use? Because some DVDs we got we couldn't even use. Capturing and logging the media. So once you've decided the disk you're going to use, you want to just get it all down and then log. What happens where on the disk? So when somebody comes to you and says, oh, I need another copy of the aileron roll because the current version I have isn't working, something's wrong with it, we know what disk to look at and where on the disk to find it. And then archiving the media. So this project was around 200 gigabytes in size. We have 4 members on my team. We got to transfer all the media around between. So just imagine pushing 200 gigs worth of data around. A few things we learned from that, FAT32, we had a mix of Mac and PC devices on our team. FAT32 has a 2 gig file size limit, but it works with both Macs and PCs. The NTFS is not Mac writable. You can get larger file sizes on it, but the Macs can read it, but they can't write to it. And then anything that's Mac formatted, you run into the issues of PCs not seeing. However, if you get something like Mac disk, in general, you can work it through there, although for some reason that crashed a lot on us. Okay, so once you've got all the media kind of captured, you're ready to work with it, the first thing you need to do is optimize it. So if you're working with these giant HD 1920 1080 type videos and you're expecting to scrub your playhead and sync all of them, it takes a while for updates. And you know your target size is something like, say, 480 by 270. Go on and get them all down to size and get them all unified so that it'll make it easier for syncing later. Your playhead will update faster so you don't like drag it, wait 3 seconds, then make an update, wait 3 seconds, and so on. Get your media down to progressive. So if any of your stuff's coming through interlaced because it was, you know, at one time done through film and now you're going to be working with it digitally, you want to make it progressive. It's going to encode faster and it's going to be faster for your system to work with. And then unify your frame rates. So this video here is 2 pieces of the exact same video that we were working with for syncing. The one on the left here I'm about to play was at the beginning of the video. Seems pretty well in sync. I mean, there may be a little bit of delay there, but that could be attributed to the comms. So we go on and we bring that into our project. We start syncing everything. We've been working on it for, you know, say a full day of syncing. We get down to the end and our syncing software, as we're adjusting time and speed, we can't hear audio while we're doing that. So, you know, moving along, happy path, get to the end of the day and this is what you get.
150 watts. 120, all the way.
And then you shoot yourself and start all over. What's going on there? That video was at 29.972 frames per second. Now we all generally work with NTSC, which is 29.97 frames per second, so a difference of 0.002 frames per second, and that's how far off it'll get about 40 minutes into your footage. So just make sure you get them all working together, 29.97, before you get too far into your editing. And the one piece of software, quick plug for Microsoft here, the one piece of software that was able to detect all the way out to 29.972 was Microsoft Expression Encoder. And we were able to use that to get it to 29.97 so that we could work with it. And from then on, every time we worked with video, that's the first thing we did. So editing the media. So we've got all the media in, it's all unified, we're ready to start working with it. This is me speeding up one of the time sinks. We've already taken all the audio through SoundWave and we're now working with the files. And what you're seeing here is on the top, we're working with the look back camera on the pilot's face because we can't adjust his time. If we do so, he's gonna sound like Mickey Mouse or he's gonna have a really deep voice unless we affect pitch. So we're using him as our baseline. I'm identifying key points in the track, things like when the plane turns upside down, when it starts to roll, when it stops to roll, so that I know where these points on the timeline are. I'm also adding markers so that next time I come into the project, I know where the ALR roll is. I'm now turning on just one other video so that I don't have all of them syncing at the same time. And I'm just matching. I'm speeding up and slowing down the clip to ensure that it's going to play and hit these points at the exact same time. Now the next thing I'm going to do here, the planes are flying straight, so there's no point of reference as to when the maneuver begins or ends. So I'm just doing a little bit of math to figure out at exactly what point I need the maneuvers to start, to stay in sync, and to play smoothly. We tried this the first time without doing that, and the planes are flying in at like Mach 10, and then all of a sudden they slow down and get into sync, and it just looks really weird. All right, so once we have all that together, we originally did all the 3D in sync with the videos. We did the video first and synced the 3D. Problem we came across is we were swapping out that pilot cam a couple times. We'd be working with the footage, be done, and we get the phone call, oh, they just flew another show. The maneuver looks much better in this show. Go on and plug that in. So we gotta go back and renew things. So that's why the 3D, we actually have to do the time sync on that too. I erased those middle keyframes because having too many keyframes in can make the timing seem a little weird and jerky. So once it was all synced up, we put it out to render, and we're ready for encoding. So just a couple of rules with the encode and transcoding. Only compress things once. So if we pass the media around quite a bit, we'll put out a video, and then we'll have to take it somewhere else, add the 3D, put out a video. It's a good practice to try and keep things as uncompressed or as close to native as possible until the very end. Otherwise, you just keep compressing it, it's going to degrade in quality. Second thing is the output to stills and then to a sequence. So anything that's taking a long time to output, you know, the frames are pretty complex. 3 hours into it, it crashes 90% of the way. You got to start all over, that really stinks. So go to stills, because then you can pick it up where it left off, finish it out, and then once you have the stills, compress that to your various formats. Atom placement. Have you guys ever had the experience on a website where it starts playing a video and it's all, you know, real fast, and all of a sudden about 80% of the way through the video it slows down and starts playing at the appropriate play speed? It's because the atom, the information about the frame rate and the file size and such, is at the end of the video instead of the beginning. That occurs because video software generally puts the atom at the end of the file as opposed to at the beginning of the file. Web software will put it at the beginning. You can use programs like Qt Index Swapper to move the atom from the end to the beginning. So the encoding software we use, Adobe After Effects, the Adobe Media Encoder, Microsoft Expression, Firefog, Handbrake, and the Bitrate Calculator. So the Bitrate Calculator just kind of told us what kind of bitrate we should be working with to get good quality across. The first was for the After Effects and the Media Encoder were more for just getting the files, you know, transferred around and prepped. Expression to encode for IIS, and then Firefog and Handbrake we're using for the HTML5 encodes. The formats we use, QuickTime Animation, that was a great one because it's really good quality and it supports an alpha channel. So when we were first working with those jets, we were able to maintain an alpha channel while we were working until we were ready to go to our final formats. WMV was used for the IIS encoding. WebM, MP4, and AUG, as I discussed earlier, were for HTML5. All right, so the 3D portion, used for the aircraft section and inside the demo. First question that arises when we come to 3D a lot of times on the web is, should we do real-time or pre-render? So real-time, I don't know about you guys, but a lot of times if I've got an object or I'm walking around in real-time, I end up in a corner, the thing's upside down, and it's really hard to get flipped right back. Just the UI's currently a little struggle, a little bit of a struggle there. Also with real time, you have to watch your poly counts, your texture sizes, because your frame rate may drop. The system that you're running on may not have, or the system you're running inside may not support any sort of hardware acceleration. So you've got a little less quality possibly. There are ways to get around that with some light baking, maybe ambient occlusion or adaptive degradation. I know those terms probably don't mean as much to you, but essentially things that are further away don't have any polygons. Or things that are behind the camera aren't getting created into as high fidelity. We chose to go with pre-rendering. Again, it takes an hour for a single frame on a quad core with 8 gigs of RAM. I don't think you're going to get that in real time. What that allows us to do is some of the post-type effects like depth of field, some of the matted reflections, the blurry reflections. Overall, quality was really important to us. We knew it was really important to the Blue Angels, so we definitely decided this route was the better route. You are on a bit of a rail when you're dealing with pre-rendering, which means you're only going to see the sequences when we prepare for you. So to get around that, we'll make a few different pathways, and we'll have common in and out points on those pathways. Since we have such control over the camera, we can do that sort of thing. You do have the choice of using video or image sequence. We opted for image sequence so we could really control the compression in each frame. You can do video and just scrub the playhead as well. That's another way of doing the pre-rendered approach. And if you are dealing with the image sequences, you can compress the motion frames a little bit more, because they're only going to display for about a 30th of a second. So when it comes to 3D, these are some of the different areas: modeling, lighting, texturing, rigging, animation, rendering, post-production. I'm not going to do each of these justice. Each of these would be a career path if you went into Hollywood. So I'm just going to kind of graze over them. So modeling. This is where we create the wire meshes. Things that are further away don't necessarily need as many polygons. Keys to modeling: you want to make sure you have a nice, clean model. Your polygons are anywhere between 3 and 4 sides. You don't want anything 5 or 6. It's going to mess up your models. This is setting up the lights. We generally use photometric lights, so everything is physically calculated. So for us, it's very important that you work in a real world scale. You don't have like a 2-inch plane and then you're trying to set all of your lights and things appropriate for it, because when we drop in a halogen bulb, it's going to light like a halogen bulb as long as everything is done at the appropriate size. Texturing. So we went on site and we took pictures like you wouldn't believe to figure out what everything should look like. So in here we're going to create our shaders and we're going to create our textures. Again, things that are further away don't need to have as detailed of textures. It adds to render time, especially if it's not necessary, don't do it. Animation. So this is going to involve things like rigging. All of these elements we could have animated individually, like the landing gear coming up. Instead, what we'll do is we'll animate them all and hook them into, or wire them up to sliders, so we can just slide the thing across, slide the slider, and then that's going to control the landing gear going up or down. Especially in this project, we had to constantly raise and lower things like landing gear. It also can involve things like particle systems, which I'll address in a minute. So this is just a quick example of animation. We have the camera zooming in and the landing gear going up. Particle systems. It's done node-based, and this is just an example of our particle system setup. We have a couple different options in there for the particle systems for various purposes, different planes emitting particles differently, or just for testing purposes, a particle system that doesn't emit, tens of thousands of particles that our system has to keep up with while we're working with them. So rendering, there's several different rendering engines that you can work with: Scanline, Metalray, and V-Ray are just a few that we use. There's a lot of other ones. Each one has its strengths and weaknesses. We chose Metalray for this project. And this is just really going to be setting up something that's going to take all those other pieces and put together to create an image. And there's really an art here to dealing with the speed and the quality. So for example, limiting your reflections to only maybe a couple bounces, where you don't really need a lot of bounces, or just letting certain areas not be calculated as much. Also in rendering, this is a Z-depth pass. So this is, in order to add that depth of field, instead of doing it on the fly, we would render a Z-depth pass, which is a black and white render showing the distance from the camera. You're then able to take this data in post-production and add the depth of field at that time. It saves a lot of time in your render. And you can experiment with the amount of depth of field on the fly as opposed to trying to do it during render. So here's post-production. This is after it runs through that same shot, just after it's run through things like color correction. Depth of field has been added, and obviously the lens flare had to be put in because lens flares are cool. So the time hurdle, when dealing with 3D, I'm sure I've said it a number of times, and you guys are like, why does it keep saying it? Everything takes a lot of time. A few things you can do to get around that. So modeling your models, first buying your models. In the vision demo, you saw that jet and the hangar. That was the original hangar and jet. As you can see on the left, it was a purchased model that was cleaned somewhat. This is actually a little bit more cleaned up than the vision demo was even. You can see that the reflections are a little blurrier, not so pixelated. Again, that had to do with the amount of time we had to work with renders. The right side is the model at the end. So, you know, for us, it's pretty common practice. If we can find something that gets us 80% of the way there and it costs $100, buy it. And then just get it the rest of the way there on your own as opposed to working from scratch. In a good place, we often use a marketplace called TurboSquid. So, you know, I'm guessing not many of you here are actually doing the 3D models, but go to TurboSquid, find the model that you want your team to work with, show it to them and say, you know, can you use this to get you part of the way there? As opposed to having them charge you to make everything from scratch. The key there, though, is let them approve it, because sometimes when you get a really dirty model, the mesh isn't clean, it can take longer than building it from scratch. Motion tests and prototyping. So we need to get things off to the client for approval very quickly. We don't have a lot of time to wait for renders, or we need dev to start working with it. This is an example of a test we did. We are testing out the particle system, we're testing out the motion rig, and we're testing out the motion of the jets. So I can send this off for approval and say, are the jets flying the way they're supposed to fly here? You know, are the particle tails long enough that it gives a good frame of reference? Also, the jets, you see at the bottom how the maneuver is a little bit kind of sliding. That's because we are having to test what happens when we keep these big jets in a small frame. So on the site, I don't know if you noticed, there's not a lot of vertical real estate there for the jets. If we had all the jets flying at actual size, they would have been little gnats flying around down at the bottom of the page. So we had to take some liberty there and make the jets a lot bigger, which creates some of that sliding motion. So we needed to see what that would look like. This is another test. It's just testing the rudder system on the Fat Albert. It's about 85 frames. If we were to render this out fully and then hand it to the client for an approval, it would have taken 85 hours to render. The first time we went through this, we had the two rudders moving independently. We didn't realize that they had to go together. This preview took about 10 seconds to generate. A lot easier to get your approvals that way. And we could send it off to dev for consumption. So on the rendering side, what did we have to deal with? The inside of the demo section was roughly 108,000 frames. So here we are working with the models. Kickoff render, we're like, oh sweet, it only takes a minute to render, this is going to be great. Then we start realizing how many frames we're dealing with. That would have been 75 days on one of our quad cores rendering 24 hours a day. So we were able to break it out to a render farm. So essentially we have 5 of our computers working on it, got it down to 15 days. Aircraft section, about 820 frames. I said 850 earlier, I guess it was 820. About an hour a frame. So that would have been 34 and a half days, one computer rendering 24 hours a day. Now this is assuming that our systems are rendering 24 hours a day. They're not. We got to work on them. We got to go to work from 9 to 5 every day. It's also assuming that we're only doing one pass at the renders. There were a lot of times we had to go back and re-render maneuvers. Oh, you know, well that's only 10,000 additional frames we got to render. So anything you can to get those render times down, it's really important to do so. There are other options like online render farms that you can use to help out to get about 200 systems working for you. A little less control, so it's kind of a pain, but it is an option in a pinch. Rendering in passes will also speed things up, as I mentioned earlier, with the Z-Depth. So a lot of times people look at 3D and they see it as just a way of generating assets. You know, it's just a way to generate that media. 3D, it can also be used for other things. So like, on the design side, we can help create assets. When we render, our renders come with pre-multiplied alpha channels built into our render. And we can render with passes, and we have a lot of control over what reflects, what kind of light setup we have, and what kind of camera we have. So I mentioned pre-multiplied alpha channel. For anyone that doesn't know, essentially we're keeping the alpha on R, G, and V channels, as opposed to just a single number. So it just allows for a much more accurate alpha channel. For dev, this is an example of where we were able to help them out. This is using Tony as a tool where those little red ticks on the plane on the right side, that's what we handed dev. They were able to motion track those red ticks to figure out where to place the hot spots in order to keep them from sliding as the plane rotates in a circle. So the last thing I just really want to leave you guys with is that media is important. It adds a lot to the experience. It's powerful, but just know when and how to use it. So with all of this coming about and people being able to add all these animations and media, it's just really important to, you know, use it when it should be used. Don't use it just because you can use it. We don't need 50 transitions all happening at the same time to bring in your page. Don't ask your users to download a ton of unnecessary video or other media elements because obviously they have data plans. And transitions are great. Try and keep them limited to, you know, maybe 3 to 5 seconds. I don't care how cool your transition is. If it's 10 seconds long and I have to watch it 30 times as I'm traversing through your site, it's going to get annoying. And just keep your pages from looking like some sort of Gaudi-based casino when it comes to your media. So just a few resources. HTML5 video. The first one, the video for everybody, is just a great reference for dealing with video when you're not dealing with JavaScript. So it's going to help you format your tag, get your mime types and everything set up. Video.js is the second one. It's a great library for unifying your event model, as well as it's got some really nice controls for unifying your UI as well. And then the other one's just TurboSquid. That's kind of our online marketplace of choice where we go and buy our 3D models. So Anthony Franco showed you at the beginning what the vision was. And then Cindy, Roman, Chad, myself, we showed you how we created that, what we did. And what I'm going to show you right now is just a screen capture of the actual site in action. You're going to be able to see it soon, but for now, here's the site.